Today, we're going to be talking with Dr. E. Michael Jones, the author of a book called Libido Dominante, Sexual Liberation and Political Control. This is one of the most powerful books I believe I've ever read because it puts into context a lot which has happened in our contemporary society, and it explains even more, as you're about to tell us, about the history of the West for the last 200 years. Now, one of the basic theses of your book here is the idea that sexual liberation could be used as a form of control, that it's at the very heart of the story of Samson and Delilah, which we remember from the Old Testament, goes way back, and that the idea that sin was a form of slavery was central to the writings of St. Paul. What is it, sexual liberation, political control, what is it, why is it relevant today? What? How do we see it now?
Well, it's one of the best forms of control because it's the subtlest, because it masquerades behind your passions. So what it is basically a manipulation of human passion. And human passion is powerful, and it blinds you to the fact that you're being manipulated. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is that the culture is absolutely... Now, this is a question. I don't know whether people are blind or whether we're talking about deliberate repression of people who understand the story. But the culture is absolutely adamant in not allowing any type of explanation of pornography along these lines. There is absolutely no discussion whatsoever along these lines. And so the only thing you're allowed to talk about is freedom. So people who, if you're against pornography, you're against freedom. This is the way the debate has been managed for over 50 years now. Let's say 50 years from the Roth decision.
Now, what was the Roth decision? That was
it was just an obscenity decision that basically opened the floodgates to pornography in 1957.
Pornography, free sex, sexual
because up until this time, pornography had never been considered a First Amendment issue, and obscenity was never considered First Amendment, and this was the opening of the door to allow pornography to be considered a First Amendment freedom of speech issue.
So sexual license, then free sex, free love, whatever you want to call it, then becomes an issue of freedom. It becomes an issue of liberation in the dominant culture.
Yeah, yeah. So in order to really understand it, the real dynamics of it, you have to take a step back and you have to look for examples. And I think the best example that I can come up with was the instance of the Intifada, the battle between the Israelis and the Palestinians. In 2002, the Israeli military force marched into Ramallah. And after they did that, they took over the TV stations, which is pretty much standard procedure. But after they did that, something unusual happened.
What was that?
They started broadcasting pornography over the TV stations.
Oh, they're liberating them.
Well, this leads you to a question of, well, why were they doing that? Now, I've mentioned this in talks I've given in Europe and Africa and in the United States. And in two of those three instances, there were Palestinians in the audience who came up to me and said that they were there when it happened and told me details about it that I didn't know. For example, that there were snipers on the roof of the hospital in town, and they imposed a curfew, and if you went out, you got shot. So you had to stay in the house, and when you stayed in the house, the only source of information you had was the television, and the television is now broadcasting pornography. First one station, and then basically all three, all the stations but one got taken over, and the one station that didn't get taken over broadcast in one of those little bands across the bottom of the screen that they've been taken over by the Israelis, and they're broadcasting pornography. So, you know, this is not something we're doing. It's beyond our control.
Hmm.
So the question is, why did they do that? And if you go to the American contemporary culture and you look for an explanation for the purpose or the reason for pornography or what pornography means, you there were two fairly recent cultural artifacts that explain it for you. The one is called The People versus Larry Flint, Hollywood movie, and the other one was called Boogie Nights. And both of these appeared at around the early 90s, and they appeared at that particular time for a particular reason. That's because at that time Congress was debating something called the Communications Decency Act, which was whether to allow pornography on the Internet. And this was the pornography industry's cultural offensive to make sure that they were allowed to use the Internet to distribute pornography. So you go to a movie like The People versus Larry Flint, and Woody Harrelson, for some reason, they picked him to play Larry Flint. I don't know where, I guess Jabba the Hutt was had other obligations at that time. But anyway, they got him to play it, and during the course of the movie, he says that no one is free in this country unless I'm allowed to produce pornography. And so that's pretty much the explanation. Pornography equals freedom. So if we take that explanation and we apply it to what happened in Ramallah, it's pretty clear that the Israelis were trying to bring freedom to the Palestinians.
Well, but your book and your thesis is that that's really just a euphemism for a very sophisticated form of slavery.
Well, I think anybody in his right mind knows that the Israelis are not interested in liberating the Palestinians unless we take liberation in a contemporary cultural sense. And so you have to look someplace else for the explanation. And I'm saying the real explanation can be found in places like the story of Samson and Delilah in the Bible, which is also set in Gaza. So nothing has changed in that regard.
So the idea is to get people to watch pornography or accept pornography, whether it's in the United States or anywhere else. Once they start doing that, then their passions will determine how they live their lives.
Yeah.
And the people who present the pornography will make money because people will want to feed their passions, and as these industries make more money, they'll be able to exert more influence on the society.
Right, that's pretty much the thing, the explanation. So to begin with our example, everyone's supposed to be distracted from the fact that the Israelis have just taken over your town because all you're going to do is watch pornography now. And that's pretty much what the Shin Beth and the CIA had in mind when this thing was proposed in the first place. So I think that makes pretty clear that that's the military application of pornography. It's a weapon in cultural warfare, and the group that controls the pornography ultimately ends up controlling the mind of the country where they have settled in. And so what happens, what you see here, is that the same thing happened in the United States in a less dramatic fashion over the course of the 1960s. Yeah, I think that what we're talking about is moral and pre-political. In other words, if you can control this aspect, then the politics sort of follows naturally from that. Because, first of all, you've established the parameters of control. You've established the idea that control is something that is acceptable. And it's acceptable because it's not perceived as control. No one perceives this as control. There's the libertarian argument, well, if you don't like it, well, change the channel. This type of thing. That's not the issue. The issue is who gets to determine what's on the channel in the first place. And once you get that, once you control that, then the other stuff just sort of falls into place naturally. And that was the genius of the people who were involved in this thing. They knew that the moral, sexual settings preceded the cultural settings, and the cultural settings preceded the political settings. And so if you control, it's like this narrowing, slice of pie. If you get to the center of the circle, it's a small piece, but it radiates out from there and covers a wide area by the time it reaches the circumference. And that's what we're talking about here.
In your book, you talk about roughly 200 years of history, and you talk about a number of individuals and specific events in history where these default settings were being adjusted.
Yeah, well, the main adjustment of default settings is known as a revolution.
Mm-hmm.
So the first revolution I deal with in the book is the French Revolution, because it was in many ways the biggest, it's not the only revolution, but it was the biggest revolution, the most significant revolution in the modern era. And what I'm saying here is that it's based on St. Augustine. He's the one who said that a man has as many masters as he has vices. He's the one who proposed the alternatives, and the alternatives are the city of God and the city of man. And the city of God is based on love and service to your fellow man. And if that's the case, then the city of man has to be based on the opposite. And the opposite of that love and service is libido dominandi. I got the phrase from Augustine's City of God. It means the desire to dominate other people, the dominating desire, the lust to dominate other people. And so once you turn away from the city of God, which is what France did when they killed the king, there's only one other place to go. And so what you have to do then is dedicate yourself as a part of this new culture to dominating other people. And so what you see after this, beginning with this period for the next 200 years, is the use of freedom, first of all, as the prime way to dominate people. And secondly, what the culture becomes involved in is more and more refined techniques of domination. Because, you know, if you really want to succeed, you've got to be subtle, because no one likes to be dominated.
At least not overtly.
No, that's why the term freedom is so important here, because it becomes the justification for more and more sophisticated and elaborate forms of domination.
What they're talking about a lot of times, freedom, is a release or a removal of any sort of obligation to others or to God or to morality.
Yeah, it's usually the standard liberation is, I am going to liberate you from the bondage of morality. Well, morality is another word for reason. It's called practical reason. And so if you liberate a rational human being from reason, you're turning him into a slave or an animal. And that's what happened here. Lots of people, I don't know whether it's most people, but lots of people feel that the only thing freedom means is the ability to gratify their passions. And so these people know that, and so the regime then becomes the guarantor of your ability to gratify your passions. And so you gain, regime gains the allegiance of a certain group of people, and they become the commissars, one way or the other, either by getting paid, as in the case of university professors, or just, you know, normal people who chew you out for expressing bad ideas, which is to say, you know, where you stand up for the moral law in one way or another.